This problem involves a first-order exothermic reaction conducted in a CSTR. And in this kind of situation, you can basically have feedback from the reaction exotherm to create multiple steady states, and that's what this problem is intended to explore. We're told that the conversion is 95%, so we expect that we're at a high conversion and high temperature steady state initially, with a reaction temperature of 390 Kelvin. There's some kind of heavy storm that causes insulation to fall off, so that indicates that we're going from an adiabatic situation to one where we might expect some heat losses from the reactor. So if we observe that the conversion drops a lot to only 5%, all right, and then when we replace the insulation, we're asked, do we expect that necessarily the conversion will return to where it was before, or might we need to do something else? So we'll look at this in terms of the energy balance for the reactor. And so here is our energy balance, where we have our heat transfer term. So we have an overall heat transfer coefficient times an area through which we're exchanging heat times this temperature difference between the temperature in the reactor and the temperature outside the reactor that we'll call T sub A. We have the convective term that brings heat in and takes heat away in terms of the heat capacities of the components. Right, and then we have the term that comes from reaction. We're basically the rate with which we consume A times the heat of reaction for our component A times the volume will tell us the total amount of heat that is generated in this reaction. Okay, we'll refer to the term on the left-hand side with an R and the term on the right-hand side with a G. And if we want to look at how these might look conceptually, we can plot these versus temperature. And we're going to expect that R is roughly linear with temperature. Basically, the amount of heat that we can remove increases as the temperature inside the reactor increases. That creates a greater driving force for the heat transfer out and also allows the reactants to absorb more heat. Right, so we expect that R of T increases as temperature increases for an exothermic reaction. Right, and then in terms of G of T, we expect that at low temperature and low conversion, we'll get a roughly exponential rise in the rate of reaction, R sub A, as we increase the temperature based on an Arrhenius dependence. All right, but then at some point, once we get to complete conversion, then the reaction rate will level off with temperature, that we can only consume all our reactant and generate that much heat. And so we expect that we have to level off at some constant value at higher temperature. And so the G of T curve has this kind of shape. And we expect to actually be able to operate the reactor where the energy balance is upheld. So those would be intersection points. The middle intersection point is generally not stable. And so we can operate at either high or the high or the low intersection points. And in the initial state in this problem, we're operating at the higher point where we're achieving high conversion of 95%. Again, we don't necessarily know that we're at this point of multiple intersections. We just know that at least one intersection, so the R of T curve, for example, could be shifted over significantly to the right. We just know that we're operating at pretty high conversion initially. All right, now we look at the case where the insulation falls off. And so what we expect is that that's going to greatly increase the overall heat transfer coefficient. All right, so the insulation basically makes that heat transfer coefficient vanishingly low if it's very well insulated and we have an adiabatic reactor. All right, but so now we expect that heat transfer coefficient is going to go up, and we see that's going to increase the slope of this curve. All right, it will also affect the intercept, but we'll focus more on the slope in this case. And what we see can happen is that if we increase that slope, then we can change the R of T curve, right, so that the slope is high enough that we only get an intersection with the lower part of the curve, the lower part of the G curve. All right, and so if this happens because we're able to remove heat more rapidly, then we will expect to operate at low conversion. Okay, then we might imagine that if we replace the insulation, then we can basically change the R of T back to where it was. All right, but we will tend to be operating still at this lower steady state because the history matters. And so if we replace that insulation, we would expect that the rate of heat removal would be greater than the rate of heat generation. All right, and that would force us to go toward lower temperature. right? Because we're removing heat faster than we're generating it from reaction. And we'd expect that if we were under a situation where we had these multiple intersections, that we wouldn't necessarily return to the same level of conversion. The problem asks if changing the inlet total mass flow rate could be used to return to 95% conversion after we had replaced the insulation. And the answer is yes, that it can accomplish this. And so let's take a look at the case where R is with the insulation on and we're operating at the lower steady state on this G curve that is drawn a little bit differently from over to the left, but let's assume that that's the same rate of heat generation as in our initial reaction case. All right, so the question is, can we change the feed inlet total mass flow rate to return to 95% conversion? Okay, and so one thing that we can potentially do is decrease the inlet mass flow rate. And what that will do is increase the space time in our reactor. And so since we have more time for the reaction to occur, the reaction will really begin to take off at lower temperature. The overall conversion in the reactor will be higher at any given temperature because the reactants can spend longer in the reactor. So that will tend to shift the G curve this way from the green curve to the blue curve. And we see that we can move it such that the only point of intersection would be at higher conversion. So we would ignite the reactor. All right, then if we wanted, we could return to the operation in the green that's shown by the green curve, all right, by decreasing the flow rate again. But since we'll have already ignited the reactor, then we would expect to achieve a steady state that would be indicated by this higher intersection point. All right, and so this problem is meant to point out there are actually multiple solutions to this problem since it is a bit open-ended, but it really is intended to point out the hysteresis effects, that it really matters how you got to your operating conditions in order to where you will actually be operating when you can have multiple steady states in a reactor.